Warm good afternoon to you all. We'll have the afternoon session on topology optimization. This will be taken by two experts from Delta Rapid Solutions, Mr. Daniel Amos and Mr. Sudhakar. A brief introduction of speakers. Mr. Daniel Amos has got close to a decade of experience with the industrial 3D printing or additive manufacturing. He is currently the Director India Operations for Delta Rapid 3D. Delta Rapid 3D is a company focused primarily on the industrial plastic, metal, and ceramic 3D printing applications with AM technologies like selective laser solidification, direct metal laser solidification, directed energy deposition. The company is an authorized distributor for the 3D printing majors like EOS, BM France, Lithos, Materialize, Synatrack, to name a few. Mr. Daniel Amos is a trained and certified 3D printing and additive manufacturing consultant. He has also been closely associated with professionals who are in the field of CAD and CAM rapid prototyping. Industrial 3D printing and designed for additive manufacturing field for nearly 30 years. In the last 7 years, he has been closely associated with all major areas of industrial additive manufacturing technologies for aerospace, defense, medical, tooling, automotive, and educational industries. His area of expertise has been in jointly setting up the industrial additive manufacturing and 3D printing projects and business models for various major manufacturing companies and R&D as well as educational institutes in the country. Since 2014, Mr. Daniel Amos has also been a partner and advisor with EOS GmbH India for all their industrial additive manufacturing solutions. We welcome you, sir. Coming to the second speaker of this session, Mr. G.L. Sudhakar is a senior application engineer. After finishing mechanical engineering, he was fascinated by the job opportunities in computers and underwent courses on programming, which led to design in manufacturing and integrating the same with various live projects at Bell, Fenner, L&T, to name a few. After serving a few years, he got pulled by the fantasy of multimedia and learned many software as well as worked on films. After a few years, he returned back to his roots and joined the future technology, rapid prototyping. He grew up with this technology, where rapid prototyping changed to 3D printing, then to additive manufacturing. It has been 15 years at EOS, joined as a service engineer to understand more on the systems. He served in UK and Germany for setting up of AM facilities. He's joined the application team providing various solutions and being part of Additive Minds provided a variety of advanced level training, supporting customers on critical issues,
been a part of various implant designs in medical fields, etc. Delivered more than 1500 plus technical presentations and trained over 5000 people in lower, middle and C-level management. We welcome you, sir. Over to you, sir, for the session.
thank you. Good
afternoon. Sorry, sir, to disturb you. Before we start the session, a humble request to all the participants, kindly mute your audio and video. Thank you. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you very much for a good introduction. So I hope I'm audible to everyone.
Yes, sir.
Okay, you're able to see my screen?
Yes, sir, we can.
Okay, right. Good afternoon, everyone. I think it's a tough job. I have two jobs now. One is to present the session and one to keep you awake after the good lunch. So post-lunch session is a bit tricky. Where we have to keep the audience a bit awake. Anyway, I'm used to it. Let us see how the session goes. And I'm not going to bore you much so that you can sleep sound. If there are any questions, you can just type in. We can have it at the end. Or you can unmute and you can ask me if there is any questions. So today we would see how the additive manufacturing is adoption. That means how additive manufacturing is it's in the market, how it is being adopted in the market by the industry, and what are the gaps, and there are a lot of gaps which we have found, and how we are able to bridge those gaps through the academic way. And Daniel would be giving a small presentation on the adoption. Or the bridging the gap through the academics of the academics way of bridging to the industry. Okay, let us go to the session. So today the topics would be rough topics, not many topics. So I'm not going to take you too much time. So about EOS, a few slides on the EOS we'll have, and then this is a corporate. So we are at we started in 1989, wherein we have about 30 plus years of experience, and we are in Munich in Germany. We are present in almost 67 countries. So how about this 30 years of experience? In 89-93, Hans Langer, the owner, had started the company with a statisis machine, like a stereolithography machine. Then they came up with a laser based machine, which is in 94 to 97. We had a very good breakup through on the additive manufacturing. We came up with the first plastic and the metal machines. Then in 2000, we came up with the twin laser machine, where you have two lasers and the bed size is a very big size, which is about 700 mm. In 2004, the major breakthrough was on the process, which is called the DMLS, which is the direct metal laser solidification, which came up in 2004. And in 2006 to 2009, we could able to do the mass manufacturing on the dental side, which is wherein you have a lot of copings, which is a very big industry, wherein now in 1 in 5 copings are built in 3D printing. That's how the machines have been churning out parts 24/7. Then in 2006, we came up with the entry-level machine, which is the plastic machine. And in 2010, we came up with the next generation set with the higher range of lasers and the processors, the next generation, which is the M290 machine. Then in 2013, we came up with a bigger machine, which is called the M400, which is basically a higher 400 volume, 400 cube, that is 400 by 400 by 400. So that much parts can be built on this. And in 2016, we came up with a quad laser, wherein you have four lasers in the same machine, where the process is much better. In 2018, we came up with Profusion, which is a 1 million laser or 1 million diodes are used to solidify the powder. So this gives you a very precise solidification, wherein the dimensional accuracies are very good, and you can print very tiny small parts at a very accurate rate. So this is in a very nascent stage. Still, the machine is not there. It's in a beta phase. So in 2018, we had launched this technology. We are working on this technology. And in 2019, Maria Langer, who's the daughter of Mr. Langer, had taken over as the CEO of the company. And he is the founder of the Langer has stepped down from the board of directors. So this is the 30 years of journey what we had. We have a very good journey. And a few words on the Indian office, which we have 98, which is about 10 years from where Kryling had started. So we had started along with Mr. Anand, and he was the first employee, and I'm the second employee of the sister of EOS India. So we have about 20 years of experience each, which puts together about 40 years of experience altogether with me and Anand, where we are able to get about 80 customers, be it on metal and polymer. So we have a market share in India of 65% and polymer of 45%. Here, I wanted to tell you, we are not just a machine seller. We are an end-to-end solution wherein we give you, help you, handhold you in many of the phases. For example, it's not only building the parts. After the building parts, how to certify them, how to qualify them, and all these areas, if it is aerospace or in medical, you need to do a lot of certification and qualification. So this needs a lot of expertise, which we have, as you know, that we in India itself have about 20 years of experience on these. So we have a team which does all these. So we are also involved on, it's like a handhold to everything, like be it part printing or be it any of these areas. So having been said that, India, we have innovators. I think in the space industry, this is the first part which was built for the GSAT-19, which is the feeder cluster for the ISRO, which is currently in orbit now. And second, I think you must have seen this part in the morning for the Sukhoi 30 aircraft, which was certified. And I think you have seen this information in the morning session. So then on the medical side, we have implants wherein I have been doing medical for more than 6-7 years now. And I have till now, I have been done more than 250 implants, which have been implanted in the human, and touch wood, everyone are safe and healthy. So these are a few of the achievements what we have done in EOS India. So taking to that, 3D printing is being catered in all these industries. Let us take what is the technology that we offer. Normally, we offer two. One is the SLS is for the polymer. DMLS is for the metal. Let us see the polymer. It's the same, where you have the part and then you slice and then there's a bed. The powder comes in, a laser comes in and solidifies, the bed goes. So you remove all the powder and then you get the part. So like in the morning session, you had seen that on the metal, there are a lot of supports which you need to create, so that you need to build the part. But in SLS, we don't have supports at all. So the powder in between acts as a support. So this helps us to use take the advantage of the entire build, so that you can create multiple parts on the Z also. So you can stack and you can create a series production or a batch production. For example, if there is a small parts, then you can create a few thousand parts so that there is no tools used. So it's called a toolless production. And if there is a design change, the next production, you can change the design and you can create those parts. So this is a very big advantage without having supports. But if you see on the polymers, there are other technologies where you need to have supports. You can't create a batch production or anything on those areas. You need to have something called as a curing and all that stuff. But here it is a 100% or a 99.99% dense bond because it's called solidification. Sorry, in between I might cough because I'm not well a bit. So the process goes like you have a CAD data, STL, SLI, which is the slice data, and then it goes. This you know. So on the DMLS technology, I think morning they were asking something on the DED and on the non-powder and the powder bed basically. How it works is here. You have a powder, the part prints here. The recoater takes the powder and spreads here, and the excess powder comes here. That's the collector. So the laser here does the solidification, and the bed goes down. So this is the normal DMLS process. and the non-powder, basically, you have a laser beam which comes in, and then there is a powder which is deposited to that. And with a very high energy of laser, that powder is melted and it is solidified. So here, this is more of a repair applications, which you have, you can use. Then coming to the materials, which is another major, requirement for any industry. Let us take a polymer basic. We have somewhere down more than 15 to 20 polymers, of which we have some polymers have been been certified by Boeing and by Airbus. And we also have polymers which is used for casting applications. For example, lust wax casting applications we have directly. And then we also have rubber materials or the TPU or the TP urethane or the elastomers. And also we have, it's a basically a nylon 12 material, which is almost an equal PA2200 is the equivalent to our ABS material. And we have a flexible material, which is also called PP, which is the polypropylene, and also on the PA11 material, which is a bit flexible. So it's not only that, we also have a company, which is called a sister company, which is called an ALM. This, their main aim is to develop materials based on the requirement. So based on a particular requirement of a segment or of an application, these people, the ALM people, develop a material for them. For example, if you have a high temperature material which can go up to about 400 degrees centigrade, like for example PEEK or a PEK, PEKK. So these kind of materials can also be developed. And we have systems which you can use with these materials. And there is also a flame retardant material, which is again used on the aerospace applications. So putting food four together with EOS with 14 and ALM, we have another 31. So we have roughly around 45 materials that are already directly, which you can use directly on the system. So if you want to have more materials, we can also develop them using directly in EOS or in the ALM. So we have a wide range of materials which can be used for the systems. Then how this is worked? For example, EOS is basically an industrialization kind of materials we develop, but for the ALM we'll develop on the individualization, meaning to that segment or to that particular application they work. So both we work and we have around 45 materials altogether. Coming to the metal materials, these are the base materials what we have, and in those we have a different kind of alloys. Alloys are available on this. Apart from this, we also have more than 30 types of material at different TRL level. TRL level is nothing but the technical readiness level, which is very crucial for any aerospace or medical application. These TRL levels are required because then only they can certify the material. So this is very important. And this 30 types of materials which are available, which is based on those segments or on the unique applications. So let us quickly get into the polymer side. So latest take is the aerospace. I'm not going to talk about the intricacies of all the stuff. I'm just going to show you a few pictures so that it will be easier for you to understand. These are something nothing but the fire retardant material, the FR materials, basically used on partitions, or the crew cabin partitions, or the cockpit partitions. Or you can see it when you fly on the flight, you have a partition based for the first class, business class, and on the economy. So these partitions are done on these. The major advantage here is it is fire retardant. Second thing, it is lightweight in structure. So what happens is you burn a less amount of fuel. This again in turn goes that you burn a carbon dioxide emission is less. So that way this plays a very major role. And other areas where this is used is basically the ducting areas. And the another area where they use is where they wanted to have the basically some projects wherein on the university projects where this, you can see here this portion, this entire wing is as built. So you can see this cross sections as the ribs, and these are the ribs, and these are inbuilt, and this is also as built. Nothing is assembled. So whenever you build, you can see the flaps are also built on this. The major thing, only thing is which is being assembled is these two, the electronics and the rotor which is outside. These are the things which have been built or assembled separately, but the rest of the entire thing is built as it is. So you can build functional or the living hinges you can use. Then coming to the industry, this is a helmet where you can see the honeycomb structure, which is the toughest structure in the world to break. So using these ones, so the helmet has been done, and they've also made basically with aerodynamics. And here this is customizable, so it can fit in exactly to your head. So this is customized, and it is 26% safer, and it is a perfect fit that you have. And it also goes through the safety norms. Whatever safety norms you have for this particular material, be it design, it has gone through the testing. Then we have also on the bionic assistance. For example, I have a small video, a pick and place. Basically, this is used for the robots to pick and place during, for example, in the, be it in any industry, food or anything, because again, the PA12, what is available with us is basically a biocompatible material. So it can also be used during the medical applications also. I'll come to that later on. You're able to see the video?
Yes, Sudhakar, we're able to see.
Yeah. So this is a bionic handle. This is basically, everything is plastic, PA22. Nothing is metal here. It is also assembled in such a way that they have fixers here. It automatically fits. It's a snap fit, basically. They have sensors here. And using the air, they use this movements. It's pneumatic, 100% pneumatic. And all this is as built. You can see at the bottom, it is built in segments, and using the snap fit, and they have assembled it inside. So even these hinges are as built, nothing is assembled. Sorry, I'm a bit coughing. Sorry about that. So you can even see this. It can, these things will also bend. So you will have a very precise and a firm picking of the objects. So this much it can do. You can now you can see the extent it can go. This is again a PA 2200, which is a poly nylon 22 material. So you can have different various pick and place for the bionic handles. Then again, this is a talk of the town now. I think you can see that people, the glassware people are telling within 24 hours we can give, and it is also customized. So this again is another big area where you can use it for the customized ones. Then coming into the automotive, there are something now the trend is gone wherein you can do the customized naming or customized interiors internally of your car. So the Mini Cooper, they have come up with where you have a small tab wherein you can design your own components, and then it can be fitted inside. So likewise, you can have any of this. These are all your design. The major advantage here is you don't have to have an inventory. There's no inventory. The reason being, because you are going to design it and it's going to be delivered within 24 hours. So there is no inventory for this. There is no tool design for this. So you reduce a hell of a lot of amount in this areas. So which you can do it for an R&D or anything other areas, you can spend this money on this. Again, on the interiors where you need to have few number of parts, like for example, like I told you, few thousand, you can say about you need, for example, Rolls Royce is basically handmade, and all these parts are need to be very precise or very customized. So these areas it can do, and this is again a toolless production. So coming on to the application of the metal, I think you must have seen a few of these in the morning. Maybe I don't want to repeat a certain things. And this is again a helicopter engine rotor, wherein these kind of intricate shapes can be. And you can see in the morning there was a question, what kind of a finish that you can go in for. You can see this is a mirror finish. After you do the part, you go for a post-processing, wherein you can go in for the finish as a mirror finish. And this is again a combustion chamber, where it has a lot of intricate details. For example, these are more than a million holes in this, and these holes are less than 5 mm. And normally what happens is when they do conventionally, they use a laser drilling for all these. This itself takes them for more than 3 days for them to do for this drilling. But here, as the part is manufactured, these holes comes up. So you don't need to spend that post-processing again here. So this is a very major advantage here on this. And it also has internal cooling channels. So if you see this casing here, you can see there are some bosses, and there are some other features. For example, you can see internal cavity for oils. Then there are bosses here, then cooling profiles, and then internal curved parts for the air to get. So such kind of things can be built as it is. There are some few things you showed in the morning, but here, the earlier what happens is these were separately built and then it was welded. So the problem here is once you have a welding, then there could be a cracks or hair cracks which can go for a rejection of that part. So here it is all integrated as one single part, which can be used in one single part. You can have so many features as the part is built together. And this is again an injector head for the rocket, wherein there were about 248 parts in this one injector head, had around 248. But using 3D printing, we made it as just one. The disadvantage here is if one part fails, basically because of some welding, then the entire the unit has to be thrown off. But here it's going to be only one single part, and there is no vendors or no sub vendors for this to manufacture and then supply it to them.
So it's only one machine which is going to build this part. You're going to do one testing, and then it's going to be in the assembly. So this is a very a major advantage that you have. On the automotive, I have a video which basically you can use in an engine. Okay, what are all that things can be used to reduce the weight of the engine? So I'm just going to run this. Just have a. You're able to see my the video, right? This is the Renault truck engine, basically a V6 or it's called a V6 engine. So you can see the weight reduction is about 18% of one bracket. So similarly, like this, you can reduce the weight or the redesigning of this in such a way that you can reduce the weight. This is basically used. This is called the topology optimization. Actually, morning also there were a few examples. So if you see this, this is made into 80 parts integrated as one cylinder block. So there are no 80 vendors for that particular unit. And again, this is a 45 parts integrated as one single cylinder head. Again, the vendor list comes down and the assembly lines comes down. So if there is one rejection in one part, the entire part would go off. So total weight you had, number of weight is reduced about 120 kgs. So this is the power of the topology optimization or the weight reduction. I have a slide, a few slides on the topology later on also. So then on the the conformal cooling, there was a few slides in the morning. I'm just going to explain them. Like this is a normal conventional method of design. What happens here is you don't get the cooling at this area. So but with this conformal cooling design, you can, all these red are nothing but the cooling channels. So it can go up to 3 mm of the at the wall. So the cooling happens very rapid. See, the major issue on an injection molding is the cooling time, where you have the ejection of the part. So this cooling time takes about 80% of your time. So if you are going to reduce that, then it is a big amount of profitable time that you can get. So here, this is one thing. Second thing, you have something called as hybrid design. Suppose the normal base plate or the blaze one is a normal, it is just a block. That means I don't need to create this block on a 3D printing. What I can do is I can use the same block, and we can use something called as a reference point calibration, where you can reference this and then build the 3D printed part on top of this. So you have, this is called a hybrid design or a hybrid tool or a hybrid insert, wherein you can use a normal block. Along with that, you can build wherever till this, if you're going to build this one, it's going to be waste of time and waste of money, because it's just going to be expensive. If it is a normal block, it's going to be at a cheaper price. Then on top, wherever you want this insert to be built with these features, then you can build that one also on top. So there are two advantages here. It's a hybrid, and also you can, the cooling goes very good. So I'll just show you here the conventional method. If you do in the mold flow, it takes, the cycle time is so much time, 90 seconds. But if you are going to use the DMLS, you can see the cycle time is 36 seconds. From 60% is reduced from 90 seconds to 36 seconds. So the cycle time has been reduced by 60%. And if you see on the on this diagram, where you can see the heat is almost at the top, where you don't have the cooling at this area. Okay, so you can see a red over here, but in this one DMLS, where the cooling channels are very close, to the profile. So what happens is it cools out very fast, and you can see the part you don't have a heat, or the heat dissipation is much faster compared to the conventional method. I hope I think this you can understand a bit here. And these are some of the other examples. Basically, if you see a normal thermography of a picture of a normal conventional method, you can see it's all red. That means here you can see a lot of heat. But on the additive manufacturing, you can see that there is no heat generated here. That is because of this kind of a cooling channel present inside. And not only conformal cooling is used basically on your molds. Now that we have come the heat sinks, because now you can see that our laptops or desktops are becoming smaller and smaller, and the processor speed is getting higher and higher. The performance of the processor is higher. So there you need to have a very good thermal cooling, or the cooling has to be very effective so that there is no overheating of these processors. So now people are trying to use a liquid cooling for the processors. So this is one of the copper insert or a copper cooling unit where it has a lot of holes. Now we are using a copper as a material also. As I told you earlier, you wouldn't have seen this copper in the main list, but now we also do have something called as bronze, invar, or nitinol. All these are all in pipeline. Copper is already we have released the material so that you can use the copper now, but all these materials are in pipeline for additive manufacturing. Then coming to the medical side, on a human, these are the areas wherever you see a green, all these are all implants. Okay, so wherever you see the orange or whatever color you see, yellow, are in the pipeline or it is in the evaluation mode. So these are the areas like many in India, we use mostly on the cranial or on the maxillofacial, dental, or you have the, we call it as TKR, which is the total knee replacement or a hip replacement. And then you have the facial implants. So out of this, I'm just going to show you a few implants designed where I was involved directly on these designs, which we designed and implanted into the patient. So there was actually a issue here because of cancer. This patient was having an issue here, so we did two designs of the implant, and then it was implanted onto the patient. So now you can see that this is the patient. So this is after post operation. This is the after implant has been implanted. This post after about 15 days. Similarly, we designed another cancer patient, which was again another one. So you can see here the implanted portion, the implanted part. I have reduced the color because it is a bit annoying for some people if they see blood. So I've just reduced the the implant color. So actually there are more than 200 implants which I have done. So just to show you a few, I just brought in here. We have done spine cages, spines, wherein in between the spine there is a cage which happens, and if due to any reason for cancer or on trauma or an accident, if this cages goes off, then you can use implant the cage also on there. And then another major advantage with additive manufacturing is biomimetic. That means from the nature we can get the design or the idea and then implement that onto our design. So which is not possible on your conventional method. So here, for example, this cactus tree, you can see this is smaller diameter, but the L by D ratio is very high. If you see a small diameter, but this goes up to about more than 20 feet or 30 feet, how is it able to withstand and it is not able to break? That is widely because of this kind of internal structure which is happening, wherein this holds the entire the cactus stem upright, and it also doesn't allow the heat or the moisture outside. So it's a kind of a design that we can get it from the nature. And if you are having this kind of a hollow tube, and you need to improve the strength of this tube, normally what we do is we used to increase the thickness of this tube, or we take the different material. But with the same material, with the same tube, same diameter, you can apply this information, this by kind of the nature's information, and then you can build it on this and build this tube with a higher strength. So this is the powerful. Actually, this is one example. I have another example with where we are doing heat exchanges from the shark's gill. Unfortunately, I didn't get the picture of it. So in nature, from nature, we can get a lot of information to improve our strength or design. All that can be done through additive manufacturing. Just to give you an idea, I just took one example. Okay, so coming, I hope I've just covered the basics. Let us see the main topic of today on the topology optimization. So I think you must have seen the same part in the morning session. So how this is done? So I have a small video just to show you what is this. So this is a bracket in the on the satellite for basically for the communication. The communication part is mounted on this bracket on the satellite. So this is the topology. You can see it was normally sheet metal applications, but now they have redesigned the entire stuff into this particular part so that the weight is reduced. Any question? Okay. So how it was made? So what you can see, this part is at this portion on the satellite, and currently this part is already there in the orbit. So what the original design was basically like a sheet metal. All this was a sheet metal, and there were so many screws and so many rivets. And if there is a possibility, if there is any problem due to, because at the in the space there's a lot of temperature variation, so it has, if the, these any of these rivets goes off, fails, then the entire thing goes for a six. So what happens is, this is the original design. So what they did was taken from the model, and then they conceptualized this particular design. So with this one, so let me go into this. So they have taken the model preparation. They understood where the bolts has to be come, what is the load it is going to have. So for example, these are the loading conditions at these two areas, and then how this part is going to be fixed. All that was taken. That this is the basic thing. From here, they went to the conceptual optimization. That means they did a light many iterations optimizing the design, basically with different areas. You can see this is a different design, and this is a different design, and all this in with basically understanding the tendency of this optimization. And then they also wanted to have numerical noise. That means there is a noise which comes in these areas on these segments. So that is also they were able to observe, and then they wanted to define that and then solve them. So once they did that, then what they did was they wanted to manufacture this. So how does it, because earlier it was on a circular face, but now they are changing that into a square or an I section or a different section. So how does it behave? All this was being analyzed on the concept interpretation. Then they came up with the concept design. Once they understand, okay, these are the different kinds of the model can be used. So finally, this was understood. Then they used the norm. They didn't use the normal CAD, the Boolean operation. They used a separate software which is called as the Evolve Solid Thinking. Basically, where they were able to, you can just pull this node, it will become big. So like that, they have a lot of understanding with this NURBS surface modeling, which is nothing but non-uniform rational B-spline curves. That is called the NURBS surface modeling, wherein you can go to the node level and then you can change. And then they did the detailed optimization. That means instead of, they were able to see what is the analysis. They did the analysis on top of this. They did a different types of things like loop one, loop two, like this. They were able to do it. And then finally, they were able to justify the cross section and where the load exactly happens. They did it. Then they also try to do, say, for example, you can, with the NURBS technology, you can increase this, the nodes. Basically, you just pull it will come up. So likewise, that is the design flexibility it had. Then the stress verification, like it, you have the basically the normal analysis model, analysis software. So they have also done this. And then finally, from this, where they had this original design to this design within 4 weeks, and they were able to reduce somewhere down 1 kg of almost around 1 kg of mass from this one to this one, which again increases their payload. They can increase their payload for them, which gives them a more payload can be taken because you are decreasing the weight here. So then it was built on the M400, there were two parts were built on this. Again, they were using a support structures. They were also using the test bars in between so that they can test how this particular part has been built. So all that was done, and then finally it was delivered to the customer. So this is the final part, what it was delivered on the topology optimization. So according the traditional method, this is, for example, if you want to get this, you need to go so many operations. But now with this, you can just use a CAD, DMLS, or this process, SLS or a DMLS, you can finally. For getting to do all this, we also have an ecosystem. Basically, being an EOS group, this is the ecosystem we have, wherein we have the Additive Minds, basically for you to help, for us to help you in various areas. For example, be it certification, be it topology optimization, be it analysis, all these areas we can help you. Again, we can also develop new metals, metal powders, then ALM produces polymer powders, then AMCM is basically a customizing machines. So these are some of the internal group. Then we have basically a tie-up. These are our sister concern. For example, there was one question in the morning on the supports. If there is a, how can, whether the support can be generated automatically and also manually. Yes, both can be done, but how do you validate? So is this support is enough? So this additive works will give you a simulation of it and tell you, okay, this support is enough, or if this is support is too much, so that you can get all this, like your mole flow analysis. This gives you a pre analysis simulation before you do the part. So these are our sister concerns, basically, who does this. And this Lithos is basically a company which gives you ceramic 3D printing. And Sintratech is basically a entry desktop SLS printings. So likewise, we have coloring. So the post-processing here is coloring. You can go up to more than the Pantone colors. Somewhere down around 3,000 colors are there in this. So likewise, we also have external partners, basically wherein you have a, suppose you want to have a, the lattice structures to be done, then Autodesk has a very good lattice structure module, which is called Within, which can produce a beautiful lattice structures, progressive lattice structures, which is widely used in the medical market. Same ways in Materialize, there are many modules for every on the engineering as well as on the medical side. So again, Cooks and Gold is basically, they use precious metals, which is gold, platinum, can be used with this one. So with the help of this ecosystem, we can help you right from your idea to your product. So in between, whatever, wherever the help needed, we can help you. That's how we say that we are into end-to-end solution. With this one, what happens is we are able to understand the industry needs. So we can cater the needs through academia, because academia is a very people who are going out need to understand what is there in the industry challenges. So if they are able to understand that at the academia level itself, that is much better for them. They are prepared for the challenges in the industry. So this will help them. So that is something what Daniel would be giving you right now. And thanks for your time. Sorry, I was coughing a bit, little in between. over to you, Danny. If there are any questions, you can just type in so that we can do the QA at the end.
Thanks, Sudhakar. Thank you so much for giving that background. And thank you all for your attention. And just trying to share my screen. Let me know if you're able to see it.
Yeah, we are able to see you.
Yeah. Just. Yeah. So with the background, what Sudhakar had spoken about, here I would like to take you in detail on how do we adapt this entire additive manufacturing into our structure. Or how do we address this industrial requirement that is there through the academic institutions? So when we are trying to look into that, I'll just give you a background of what Delta Rapid 3D is into. We are into metal, ceramic, plastics, and also MMCs, and completely into the 3D printing industry. And the forwarders of the company have the experience of more than a decade on the entire industry. So what we do is our focus mostly is on the design, print, and the post-processing, for which we have an ecosystem that we work with EOS being the major partner for us in all these initiatives. So looking at this, I would like to start with this question of when we are trying to look at what we can give to the industry, it's always better we understand what is the need of the industry today. Yes, we did have a talk about a lot of things from the morning two sessions. And, there is technology. Is the technology that is needed for the industry? Is it a manpower that is required? Or is it freshers that the industry is looking at? Or is it a product or any researchers that they are looking at? So when we have these questions in mind, I would like to take you through some of the questions that came up in the previous session. When we look at all these questions that had come out in the previous session, it all talks about one particular thing that the industry is looking for. And that becomes a very important thing for us. Because our questions are like, is it possible by 3D printing? Is it only the possibility of any particular process that can achieve these kind of requirements that the industry is having? All these are questions. And these questions can be addressed by one thing, that is the balance. It's a simple thing. If you look at cycling, for a person who does not know cycling, if you ask him how is cycling, he would say I will definitely fall down. But if you ask a guy who knows cycling, he can do beautiful stunts even driving the cycle on a rope. So that is all about 3D printing. If you ask somebody who do not know about 3D printing, he would probably explain it saying it's a big challenge. There is a lot of challenges. There are things that we cannot do. But if you ask somebody who's an expert, he would know the in and out of 3D printing technology, though it has got a lot of challenges. We, as experts, have understood what are the areas or how is that we need to strike a balance to get this. So when we're talking about balance, we are up against something. What is that we are actually trying to strike a balance about? And what are we up against? When we are able to understand this particular concept, I think we are at a better position to address the requirement that is there in the industry. So with that background, I think 3D printing is most talked about. And one of the reasons that we have this as a subject for us to speak today is because it is understood that it is one of the disruptive technologies. And these disruptive technologies have one thing in common that we all know is the change. So change is very common in this disruptive technology. So looking at 3D printing, let's go in detail into that 3D printing and additive manufacturing. Our focus today is only on this SLS and DMLS. And though there are multiple different technologies, why is that we would want to focus today on this? It's because the Roland Berger survey, which has looked at multiple different technologies, has understood and evaluated that the powder bed laser systems, that is the SLS and the DMLS systems, are on the top because of its performance of the industry when it comes to the industrial applications. That's one of the reasons today we are looking at this particular technology. And if you probably look at the first picture that you see here, as I told you, one thing that is constant is the change. So in 1900s, if you see the picture in the first picture, there are lot of the carts that you see, the horse carriages, and there is only one car that we are able to see, a motorized vehicle. Just within about 1913, if you look at the same street, you have only one horse carriage and everything else is actually the motorized vehicles. So this is where industries have understood that the change is something that is going forward very drastically. And where is the change moving towards? It is moving towards digitalization, and it is moving towards that particular side of the technology and development. So that is why we are actually today looking at this particular technology of 3D printing. And even in this particular slide, if we look at it, in the past 15 years, the industries which have taken things digitally are the ones who have seen a lot of significant growth in the business across the globe. Now, why do we talk about this? That is because now we understand that the technology is growing digital. And when there is change that is happening, industries want the product to reach the market very quickly. And if there is a delay in the product that is reaching to the industry or to the market by 6 months, there is close to about 66% of profit margin that gets lost. So industries want to look at this particular technology, how quickly they can, get the product in there into the industry. That is exactly what the technology is looking forward. So when we look at this entire additive manufacturing or the 3D printing technology, like Sudhakar's profile, if you would have listened to, it said he started from 3D, prototyping. So initially, if you see all those activities in the initial stages with these 3D printing systems, these were called as prototypes or rapid prototyping machines. These were not called as 3D printers, but rapid prototyping machines. And slowly it started moving into small productions, small batch productions, where it was used for small dental applications. And today it is all about the ramping up of production, looking at we no more talk about is 3D printing a viable technology? Can the materials be feasible for 3D printing? It is not about all those topics. Today what we are talking about, can we qualify it? Or how do we check the quality control? How do we ramp up production is what we are looking at. And what is the future? The future is actually digital factories. So this is exactly where we are right now. So we are into this innovators, early adapters, and the early majorities are actually coming in place. We have seen these innovators. There are a lot of innovation companies that have, or industries that have taken up 3D printing. They are slowly getting into the early adapters. So we have become slowly the early adapters of the technology and moving into the early majority. But when we are transiting, there is always a chasm or a gap that is there. So this is exactly where we will have to see how we can pitch in to bridge these gaps that are existing, because there are certain industries that would actually come from the innovators and going into the early adapters. And there will be certain of the industries that would getting in from early adapters into early majority. So when we are trying to go into this transition, there's quite a lot of bridging that needs to happen. That is where we strongly feel education has got a major contribution that we can bring into the industry. So I do not want to repeat this slide, which Sudhakar has already gone through, but I would want to emphasize here, stop here for a moment on what is happening in India. When I say about adapting the technology. You know, if you see in 1999, it was an educational institute which took that initiative to adapt this technology in CMTI here in Bangalore. So once that adaption had happened, you can see the drastic growth of the technology that has taken place in the country, where multiple achievements has happened from, you know, aerospace, defense, and in various different sectors, like in the dental copings, and even in the, there was a breakthrough into the tire molds. All these took place only after this industry, the education industry had adapted this. And in the second phase, if you see, the medical industry took to a next level when another education institute or a research institute took up this technology into the medical realm, where you saw case studies that Sudhakar had worked out, which has been showcased, how it is taken up in the medical side. So what is it for today? What is the industry looking at? The industry today is looking for the digital side of the additive manufacturing. So the digital side of additive manufacturing is exactly where we can bring in these contributions. These were some of these areas that I was showcasing it to you, which Sudhakar had also taken us through. So now, when we are looking at this digital side of 3D printing, we had done a survey with close to about 500 participants from both the companies and individuals. And in the survey, what we have understood is the biggest challenge is the lack of knowledge, the lack of know-how that is existing in the industry. So because of which, there is a fear, there is a question, there is a delay in adoption of the technology. And it becomes a bigger challenge, and it becomes, that is the one which is creating the gap, which is close to about 49% of them have agreed that there is a gap in terms of the knowledge transfer. So this is exactly where we are looking to see how we as education institutes can also bridge this gap. So for us to bridge this gap, we need to understand what is the process chain of the 3D printing on a whole, both on plastics and metal. Yes, we do have ideas. Ideas come in place. Once ideas are there, we have the design of products for additive manufacturing. We design these ideas. We recreate the ideas into visualization in our software tools. Then we have the 3D printers. So once we have 3D printer, we print the component and we go for post-processing like heat treatment, polishing, surface finish. But unfortunately, the today's misconception that we have is some of the industries, they understand that if they buy a 3D printer, they have the complete technology or knowledge into their hands, which is something that we have understood is not the right way of looking at it, because a 3D printer itself does not give us any knowledge. That is basically because when we understand this process chain of additive manufacturing, close to about 60 to 70% of the learning is not on the machine. It is on the digital side of 3D printing. So this had given us a bigger enlightenment to understand that it is not the machine which is giving us more knowledge, because whatever R&D or whatever kind of research that is needed for the machine is already done by my R&D team there in Germany, and the machine is fully loaded for us to get the deliverables done. But what is the machine going to deliver? Whatever we feed into it. So what do we feed? How do we feed it? It is all on the digital side. It is all on the digital side. So this entire learning of how do we select this part? How do we design? Once we select the part, we directly don't go and print the part. We need to look at the component of how we actually redesign it. We'll look at this. This is particularly where Sudhakar was talking on the topology optimization. So once we redesign the part, we will have to prepare the data. So after we prepare, we simulate the data, generate the supports, build simulation, time simulation, all of this comes into place even without a machine. It's all on the digital side. And what is the industry looking at today is this exactly is what industry is looking at, because this knowledge is actually lacking, which is close to about 60 to 70% of the knowledge of the additive manufacturing, the process chain. And this comes with only about 10 to 15% of the investment compared to the machine investment. Because when we look at an investment on the machine, it takes about 80 to 85% of our investment. But in terms of the learning, we have 70% of the learning on this digital side. This is exactly what the industry is looking for us to support them in today's context. So when we look at that, what happens? We have a complete process chain inside this digital side of the 3D printing. To begin with, we actually select a part. And we will have to create a business case. How do we do it? So for us to get a business case done, we need to look at a particular component, study the component technically, and also its economical fit. So both the technical and the economic fit is going to strike a balance for us to prove out that this is a particular component which has got a better case study. I mean, this is the same component we are re-emphasizing, which Sudhakar had also shared to us in detail on the topology optimization. So when we take this component, does it fit into the current AM system? That is the first question that we look at. So whether it fits into the exact platform that we right now have, and are there materials that are available? Does it fulfill the AM design rules? These are the basic evaluations that we get done. Then secondly, how higher are the products production cost? So this gives us the economic feasibility. Are we saving in terms of the supply chain costs? And in all the topology optimization case studies, including the automotive case study that Sudhakar had shared, we can see how we are saving in terms of the supply chain as well. And what is the value addition that additive manufacturing is bringing? So probably when we are looking at this, first two questions, we actually will be able to pave a way forward in how we actually take this business case forward as a successful component for additive manufacturing. So when we do all that, we get a scorecard of the optimal technical fit and an economical fit, where we are able to understand, we are actually reducing more than 20 different parts into one single part, where the quality issues are addressed and the time to market is also taken care of it. So when we are taking this part into place, where initially when we take this existing part, it might fall into this particular category. It would have a low feasibility in terms of economics and also in terms of the technical fit. So ultimately, once we select the part, if it is an ideal candidate after the selection, what we do is we slowly try and push this into the red region, which is actually we need to get into redesigning. So in this process, we try to redesign it to push the part into this particular category. From here, we still optimize the design, and our ultimate aim is to push the part onto this place where we actually have a very high economic and a very high technical feasibility. This is the entire metrics in which we will be actually looking at how we select this part, including with the topology optimization and the digital tools that are available with us. So while we are trying to do that, that is where we get a complete economic and a technical fit onto the higher side. So I don't want to have to repeat all of this, because this is exactly what Sudhakar was also sharing to us. So when we're trying to do this, a couple of things play a major role. And supports was something that Mr. Niranjan also addressed to us in the morning session. And Sudhakar also spoke to us a bit on the supports. So when we look at supports, we, on the metal side, definitely need to have supports. On the polymers, as Sudhakar mentioned, we have no supports because of our process advantage. We don't use supports at all because our powder itself acts as support. But on metal, we cannot remove the supports completely, but we need to optimally see how we can utilize these supports, because supports cater to two different major requirements of ours. One is to take care of the distortion, and it takes care of the thermal stresses. So there are various different supports. So once you make sure that the part is feasible for this additive manufacturing, we will have to get into the support structures that has to be developed. So there are various different support structures based on the angles, based on what is the degree at which you're printing the part, and based on different overhangs, we will have to consider what are these supports. I will not get into it more technically into it, but rather I would like to showcase this entire concept of supports. So once we understand how these supports are taken forward, there are various different supports that are there in place, which we can utilize to see how we can optimally get this built. Our ultimate aim here is to see how we can reduce the support, but we cannot completely remove the supports. So for us to get this done, we need to play with the orientations. So when we are building, we can either build it on a horizontal way with various different design changes. So the supports also changes. So we have different support here. Here we integrate the support as a part of the part itself. So the supports become integrated part and very minimal supports are there. And we have another orientation in terms of having it vertically built. So you have only two supports that come into place and you still optimize the design and you have no supports except for the lower portion of it. And this gives us bigger advantages with the orientation and the DFAM coming into place, which is actually the design for additive manufacturing. So still further, we can optimize on the design itself with DFAM, design for additive manufacturing, where your design itself completely is optimized. And once the design is optimized, you are completely building a part even without supports. That is also possible because all that is integrated. So this is exactly what we are looking at and what the industry is looking at to consult them, because printer is not what the industry is looking at, but the industry is looking for the knowledge and know-how of how do we feed in the right component, how do we orient the part, how do we do a DFAM, how do we do the topology optimization, and how do we get the ready file prepared for the printing to be done. So what we do is, to get this build challenges to address, we have different digital tools that are available with which actually gives you an entire machine platform digitally, where you can simulate, integrate the part into the build platform, orient it. All these activities that we had done here is actually done digitally with these digital tools that are available with us. So we use these digital tools to get the part designed, oriented. Then finally, we do a simulation in terms of calculating like what is the timing that it would take to print a part. Because once we have the technical feasibility, we need to also have the economic feasibility. For us to have the economic feasibility, we need to know what is the time that it is going to take for us to print this particular part. So for us to get that, we need to run a simulation. I cannot build a particular part and try it out just for me to understand the economic feasibility, because the metal is actually expensive. So we do it all virtually with these digital tools even before we go in for printing. So once all that is done is when finally we go in for printing using the EOS Print, which actually is a machine interface software which helps us to get this slice data transferred into the machine. So with all this, what are we trying to do? When we are trying to strike a balance, we are striking a balance between the quality and the cost. So what are we fighting against is the time. So when we are fighting against the time, we need to match the quality and the cost. So these are the hidden enemies that we are fighting against, we would not be able to say enemies, but we will have to address to them because we will also have to quickly get this done because we are against time. So when we are getting this done, we need to understand one basic triangle, that is, we have the system, we have the material that is there in place, and we have the, just a moment. Just let me know if you're able to see my screen. I think I clicked onto something. Is my screen visible now?
Yes, sir, we can see.
Yeah. So we actually have the system in place. So we have the machines, which are the 3D printers. Then we have the material. So we have materials also in place. And the biggest challenge today is to see how do we strike a balance between these two to achieve a quality, and how do we address to the price? Because our focus should be on the feasibility of the part quality and the price. Because not just getting a technical fit would actually meet our requirement, but we will also have to see how we can manage this material and the system with the process that is available, the digital process that is available with us, that is through the DFAM and through the topology optimization, and also with the right parts that are being selected. So that all comes in the digital process, which strikes a balance between all these three for us to get into the next phase, where we are able to address to the quality of the part. And not only the quality, we will also need to know how we address to the quantitative requirement, which actually, when we are able to address these two with the process parameters that are there with us on the digital front, that is when we are able to address to the industry requirement of reducing their pricing. Because this plays a major role, not just reducing the pricing, but also in terms of studying the price feasibility or the economic feasibility of the entire component. So when we are able to strike a balance between this entire three concept here, that is where we are able to get a complete business case done for the industry. And this kind of an initiative is what the industry is looking at, along with the topology optimization and the other subjects that we are looking forward at this point. And for us to achieve that, we don't even need to have a metal system or a polymer system, because what happens is 70% of the learning lies on the digital side. And for us to get into the digital side, we don't need to wait any longer for us to get a machine in-house. But the industry is already looking out for such experts and such consultancies to be done, which brings in academia at the better position to play a major role in supporting the industry. Because for printing, we anyway have our service providers, we have our print firms that are available through which we can get this printing done. So that is how we will be able to create a complete business case in supporting the industry from an academic point of view in terms of getting engaged with the live industrial projects. So when we are trying to get this done, we have a lot of different topics that we cover in regards to how we can get into that know-how and knowledge of developing our skills in addressing to the need of the industry, by getting the AM readiness achieved, and also by developing the AM applications. And we also go for the ramp up of production and the quality. So when we are addressing, we would probably look at this particular block of how we take care of it in regards to getting the trainings done in terms of identifying the right part, knowing the basics of the technology, because all the industries would have a knowledge of additive manufacturing to an extent. So from there, we pick it up in terms of introducing the know-how of the technology from where the company is already at, and try to make them understand or give them the introduction or the background to the technology. And when we try to understand how do we do the part screening. So once we select these parts, we need to know how we get into the redesigning for additive manufacturing, which is also called as DFAM. Designing for additive manufacturing with adapting to the value additions of 3D printing. So once we are able to do all of this, most of this on the digital side, then we look at in terms of the production, how we scale up for materializing or manufacturing these parts through the 3D printers. So currently what the industry is actually looking for, currently the industry in the existing needs, if we see what I've put it in red, the AM adaption has become a big challenge because of the knowledge transfer. And that is exactly where the academia could play a major role in terms of bringing in the AM adaption for the industry in transferring the knowledge. And DFAM is another place where we need experts in terms of design for additive manufacturing and part selection and business case development. These are the existing industrial needs. And though there are also other needs, in terms of during the COVID, we did need to have these digital tools because people were not able to come out of, during this lockdown time. And, if you check with Sudhakar, he would give you a lot of case studies on how we were able to, even during the lockdown, able to get parts printed for various different applications with these digital tools, where people were able to get the designs done from wherever they were. And it was thrown into the print farm, and we got it printed from our print farm and got it delivered. So that is also possible. And the post-COVID, there is also going to be a greater requirement in terms of digital tools, digital implementation, and even in terms of the virtual and distributed printing that would come into place. And there are also other needs that we could look at. And in the second level, we can also we also foresee there is also a lot of major requirements from the process development, newer materials to be developed, and certification, because any kind of a part that is printed for aerospace, defense, and or for space application has to go through a very stringent qualification criteria and certification. So all those are areas which education as or academia as institute and research institutes can play a very great role into the entire concept. So this is EOS is a company which believes in an ecosystem. Probably if you had seen the last slide of Sudhakar, you would have seen a lot of ecosystem partners then around that. And the same way, we have quite a bit of ecosystem partners even here in India that we jointly work with for the softwares. And we have partners that we work for the materials, specifically in terms of even in terms of manufacturing the materials in country. And then we have domain partners who are specific to domains like tooling and dental, and even into the medical industry. Then we have the association with a lot of these associates who get a lot of additive manufacturing programs done. Then we have the finishing partners who are there along with us. Let me come into this red block later. We have the finance partners also. Coming to this red block, if you see, we have also the training partners and the academic partners. So in terms of the training, IIM training partners, we have like Anna University, Indo-German Troll Dome, and SICRI, CTTC, and others. And academic partners like IIT Palakkad and IIT Kharagpur, sorry for the typo there. So this is exactly where the industrial industries are looking for the academic institutes to partner in terms of supporting them with additive programs that can help them to develop their internal skills or the know-how and knowledge and get into the live projects, not just about case studies that have been showcased elsewhere, but industry is looking for partners to from the academic side to support them in terms of live projects on the metal and plastic additive manufacturing. So for us to get this entire process of supporting the industry, we also have come out with a concept called Center of Excellence, working along with the academic institutions. We can get the Center of Excellence done with various different phases. Like phase one would be an AM consulting program. Then phase two would be an authorized AM training center for EOS. So we call it ATC. Then we have AM labs that comes into place. Then we can even go for advanced AM labs where all these are put together. So these are some of the concepts that we have, how the education can actually take part in terms of adapting this topology optimization, adapting the design for additive manufacturing, adapting the AM digital concept into the entire ecosystem. So for us to get this done, we need to understand what is this AM digital tools, what is this print farm that we are referring to, and what is additive mines. So when we are looking at all this, initially what happened when we were looking at these 3D printing, it is only a printer that we were looking at. So inside the printer, we had these tools, that is the softwares that were coming in place. So it was all going through together as one bundle. So today, understanding that 70% of the learning is on the digital side. What the industry has done, specifically EOS has done, is like we have taken the hardware separately and the digital tools separately. So this is actually helping industries to actually adapt to the digital tools, which helps in terms of part screening, selecting the right parts, doing a design for additive manufacturing, creating a business case without even spending on the, on buying a printer. It's less than about 10% of the capital investment compared to a printer. So you get these digital tools in-house. We are able to equip ourselves, our teams, or our faculty with these digital tools, and we are able to directly consult to the industry. So what do we do after we are able to get the design of this particular part done? We need to get the part printed for the industry. So we have a lot of print firms that are available. We have multiple of our print firms with multiple you know, machines that are there in place. So whether you want a smaller component to be printed, we would have a small machine. You want a larger component to be printed, we have the larger machine, which is M400, and we also have the mid-range systems. And I mean, varying from polymers to metal, any of this. So our print firms would be there to support you. And if you had listened to the morning, the video that Mr. Niranjan had shared, they, I mean, all of these I mean, organizations look at, you know, integrating multiple systems into their facility. That's because the digital side of it is going to be taken care of, and the printing is going to go into these kind of print firms that are coming in place. So this is going to help the industry in this particular way. So when we talk about this in entire concept, the institute would be equipped with a complete digital setup in the university or in the college. Then there would be an EOS team, which is actually called the Additive Minds team, which would be the consulting wing where Mr. Sudhakar would be playing a major role in terms of supporting the entire initiative of you know, transferring the know-how, knowledge, and even in terms of transferring the know-how, knowledge, when we are working with the industry, the quality plays a major role. So Additive Minds team, along with Mr. Sudhakar, would take care of that quality control when we are going for printing. So then we send the components to print firms, and the print firm get it printed and delivered directly to either to our customer's doorstep or even to our doorstep, wherever it is required. And the bigger advantage is, like, we have these print firms spread across the country in various different locations in the country. And also, if there are any international projects that are coming up, you don't have to hesitate today saying that you do not have a printer, because we have the connects across the globe with our print firms. And even if it is a component that you would want to get it printed in France and get it delivered for a particular company there, we would be able to get it done, printed in France, which is economically would bring in a lot of feasibility for us to take care of this particular projects. So what is the advantage that we see from this when we are looking at this digital concept, when we adapt this digital concept? Firstly, it gives us this industrial additive manufacturing exposure inside our campus, even without investing the capex on larger machines. We have the entire digital setup in-house where we are able to get access to all these machines in our from our institute itself. Then it also enables us to go forward in terms of you know, getting these certified trainers. You know, we have the certified trainers, then we have this multiple materials, and we have a complete access. So this is exactly the process flow that we are looking at on how the digital tools was going to help us in terms of the knowledge transfer and how we will be able to get this printing done from various areas. So I'm just quickly rushing up in terms of, you know, we would be also helping the institute in institutes in setting up this curriculum. And what it ultimately is looking forward is, we are looking to set up, you know, these kind of digital 3D printing team in the institute, which is going to become a center of excellence for both the plastics and metal system, by which we will be addressing to a lot of the industrial challenges through these digital tools. And we create industry partnership along with EOS. So when we get all these done, starting from the equipping till the partnership, what it ultimately brings as a result is, it gets into the revenue generation. And it also paves a lot of opportunity for placement, because today industry is looking for a lot of, you know, equipped, skilled persons to get into the technology, because the industry is adapting onto the technology in a greater pace. Once that happens, there is a greater recognition, and it actually is looking forward to meet to the vision of the country in terms of Digital India Initiative and the Industry 4.0 initiatives. So this is exactly what we are looking at, to see how we can strike a balance between the you know, cost and the quality, fighting against the time, to see how we will be able to get the entire concept of additive manufacturing supported to the industry through academic institutes. So that is where the entire concept that we are focusing towards, to see how we could support the education institutes to take this initiative forward. So a couple of educational institutes and also the industry that is using the technology to a greater extent. And that is it. I just wanted to share with you for the day. And thank you for your attention. And I mean, we can open up for any questions that you have, and we can take it forward.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, participants are requested to post your questions on the chat box, or you can also unmute and ask. So we have one question from Professor Sheetal. It's on challenges in 3D printing.
Yeah, I mean that's actually a very vast subject that we can look at. As I told you, like I gave you an example of this cycling. So if we generally ask what is the challenges in cycling, yes, there is quite a bit of challenge in terms of how we strike a balance. In a similar way, there are challenges for 3D printing, starting from identifying the right component for 3D printing. Not every component is the right candidate for 3D printing. And once we identify the right component for 3D printing, there is also a challenge of how we actually, whether we directly print the component or do we actually do a design optimization to see how we can get this part actually, technically and economically feasible for 3D printing. So once we do the redesigning, again, we have the challenge of getting the right supports in place. So we do the orientation on how we get the right supports in place. So once we have the support in place, we need to look at how is the printability. So what is the right material that we will have to look to print to achieve the right properties. So all these are challenges. Yes, there are challenges, but it doesn't mean that the challenges are holding the technology back. That's exactly what I was telling you in the initial stages. Today, we are not talking about whether 3D printing is a viable technology for us to adapt for our manufacturing. No. Today, what we are looking at is how this 3D printing is going to bring in a kind of a digital revolution. Because it's a digital technology and there are quite a bit of opportunities that are there inside an industry itself for various different components. And the industry is looking at how they can use the benefits of the technology to address the challenges that they are having with a particular component or with a particular process that they are not able to achieve with the existing conventional manufacturing. So
put it in a nutshell, sorry to break you, Danny.
Yes.
To put it in a nutshell, whatever Danny had explained, see, actually, that is what the digital tools are for, to bring in to all these challenges needs to be addressed. That is where we brought in this digital tools. So here you learn the 60 to 70% of challenges on the 3D printing. So
the next question.
Yeah.
3D printing is almost old technology. Nowadays, is it correct?
See, it's a 3D printing is actually earlier it was called rapid manufacturing or additive. See, now the latest technology remains the same, but only the concepts are a bit different now. The thing is, it is called now additive manufacturing. That's the latest word for 3D printing. I don't see that it's an old technology because I've been in this technology from 98. So only thing is it's been evolving and coming to the latest industry requirement, it is getting evolved. I think the next question is, if I want to give you an order for some products, is the service available from you? Yes, you can contact Mr. Danny for that. He can help you out in getting it.
Right.
And Vishwanath Bhanu, sir, can you use metal matrix composites in printing? Metal matrix composites, yeah, but still we need to check whether these, because see, there are a lot of things when you are going to have a metal matrix composite, there are a lot of things that we need to take care of. So if you can, we can take this separately, maybe you can contact us, maybe we can take this separately because it's a very big subject. Yes, yeah. It is possible.
Yes, just to add on to what Sudhakar said, like EOS has got an ecosystem. So we have one of our ecosystem partner. They are greater in terms of exploiting this technology specifically onto these MMCs, and we can definitely get you a lot more details into this. You can reach us out. My contact details are also available, and I've also put my contact details on the chat box. You can definitely reach out to either me or Siddhartha.
Yeah, the next is what is the criteria and requirement for setting up your COE institute? Yes, this is what the last thing what Mr. Nani had given. So yeah. The last slide, so maybe you can contact him. He can help you in setting up the COE in your institute.
We have a process of evaluating the entire opportunity on how you would want to look at this center of excellence. So we can look at the way that you would want to go forward. And these are not standard COEs. We customize it based on the kind of application or the requirement that you're looking towards addressing it to the industry. Or if you would also want to see how you can set up an entire curriculum to address not just to your institute, but also to the institutes around you and set up an excellence center. So we can definitely support you on that.
Yeah. Then, sir, does 3D printing technology could replace casting and forging as manufacturing process? One thing I wanted to emphasize here is 3D printing or the additive manufacturing is not a replacement for any technology. It is an enhancer. Say, for example, if you say casting, still the lost wax pattern casting is very, very widely used. But we have also a powder material which is called prime cast. In my slides, you should have told this. Basically, yes, this one, say, for example, if you take automotive segments where they develop engines, they use this material very widely because the prime cast, because the ash content 0.02%, which is negligible, and the burning is very fast. So that way people use it. So it is not replacing, it is an enhancing technology. You cannot, additive manufacturing doesn't replace any technology as such. And for the forging, yes, for forging, we are still in a, the additive manufacturing is not evolved where it can enhance a forging site. Still, we are able to try to do here and there a little bit of forging areas, not on major side. Then I'm doing ME and want to do ME project and manufacturing challenges. So is it possible to work with your organization on a live project? Yes, you are welcome. Maybe you can just leave us your contact before we have any projects coming, because I am an external guide for in Anna University also, and in other areas. So I can, if there are any projects, maybe I can, we can help you out doing that. Then can FDM be applied for low volume production? Okay, FDM, you can't do a serious or a low volume production because you cannot stack. You cannot take the entire build volume like what you do in SLS, because you can stack it in SLS where you can create 1,000 parts or 200 parts depending on the part size. But in FDM, you can't do, because FDM also has the support structures to be done.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was referring to when we were talking about assuring the quality, and also quantity comes into place. So when it comes to production and industrial application, the quality and the quantity also plays a major role when it comes for production, because you would need to have these volumes coming in place, either it is low volume or larger volumes. So that is where the SLS and the DMLS technology has got an edge, where you are able to apply these advantages that Mr. Sudhakar mentioned, like stacking and also building without supports and all that.
Hello. In continuation, I could like to ask whether SLS printing will be cost effective as compared with FDM right now in current scenario, not COVID scenario, but right now the cost of FDM material is around like 1500 per kg.
See, when we are looking at it on a production scenario, what we would be looking at is like in terms of multiple number of parts. So probably to give you one example, if we actually take one pen that we want to print, just an example, if it is going to take about 1 minute to print one pen on an SLS system, if you're going to print about 100 pens, it is not going to take about 100 minutes for you. So what will happen is like the technology itself provides you advantage in terms of not just, you know, assembling the parts just on the platform, but even you can stack it one part on the other part. So which gives you a time advantage. So instead of getting 100 hours, you will be able to print the entire build volume or 100 pens in about probably 6-7 hours. So that is where the entire technology gives you an advantage, which becomes, the throughput is actually better. So when the throughput is better, your costs actually come down, cost per part comes down very drastically.
What I want to ask you is like that's fine. Means you are like saving on time. So if I want to print a particular model and it takes 1 hour in FDM, and if I want to let's say print 100, so either I have to employ 100 machines or something like that. So, but the cost like SLS powder. You say SLS powder. So what will be the cost in one? Time is understood that.
I understand you wanted to have a cost, the cost per part produced in a FDM and produced in an SLS. What is the comparison? Is that your question?
Yes, yes.
Okay. Obviously, the FDM would be a bit cheaper. The reason being, because FDM machines are like, there are flooding of FDM systems in the market. So obviously there will be cheap material. Okay, there are local materials which are already available. So it will obviously you'll have a cheaper material as well as, and the it's just a desktop that you can use it. But if you're taking an SLS, it is the industrial printing and the materials are not local. You have to certain areas you have to import certain materials. Then obviously there will be the cost is a bit higher when compared to an FDM. That's my honest answer to you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Then another question is scope of 3D printing for food production and food packaging industry. Any specific training or internship available? As I told you, the materials are biocompatible because these materials are used for TKRs, like for example, the total knee replacement. So what happens is it just comes in contact with the blood and also on the bone. So what happens is this is a biocompatible material. So even on four, it can be used. And on the packaging industry, I have worked for a blister packing, basically for the medical industry. Yes, it is possible. We have done a lot of work on those areas, packaging industry. For training and internship, I don't think we can currently give. But if your college or anything has a few number of people, maybe we can do a schedule of training there at your place. Then how about how the student community should be trained with digital tools like CAD/CAM, CAE, for making them employable for future? Okay, so CAD/CAM, CAE is the first stage of the digital tools. I think that is what Mr. Daniel had explained to you, from the four pillars or the four possible on the COE. You can choose any of them so that your people, your students can be trained, or your students can get that knowledge or that industrial knowledge so that they can be competent enough for the industry. And is SLS cost effective as compared with the FDM? That's what I told you earlier itself. Yes, FDM is it's a throwaway price. You have the machine and also on the material. So obviously it will be a bit lesser compared to SLS. how to control quality in 3D printing? What are the tools and methods for the same? Quality control, yeah, that's the reason we have something called as process parameters. You can control the quality by that. We also, because we are in the field for more than 30 years, we have something called as part property profile, which is a standard parameter. If you use this parameter with the system, with the same material, if you print a part even in Australia or in India or in US, all the part or the parts will have the same properties. That's how we have standardized our process parameters to that particular machine. Because being in the in this industry for 30 years, we have standardized those. Are you working on any biomaterial or 3D printing? If you are talking about biodegradable, no. Biocompatible, already we have PA12 material as well as PA11 material. We have a biocompatible, not biodegradable. We are not currently working anything on the biodegradable material currently. I think that was the last question. I think I could see.
Yeah. If any more questions are there, could you please put it in the chat box, or we can conclude the session if nothing more.
There's one more which has come.
Yeah.
Tools for design for additive manufacturing. Digital tools for design for additive manufacturing. I didn't understand the question. Sorry. Mr. Ravi Kumar, you can just elaborate, then I can answer that question. Prakash would like to know if you can help in proceeding further. You're working on biomaterials. Maybe we can try, if you have these materials, maybe we can try to use these materials in our system and we can get some parameters done. So I don't think it shouldn't be a problem. We can help you, not a problem. Sorry, Prakash, we can't do any filaments. Ours is only SLS, only powder technology. Then Chakrabarti has asked if there is any program or internship for PhD students pursuing PhD in the field. We don't do any programs in EOS. We only help the college or the university to do a program. We give them, help them to get a curriculum on that, and then we back them, we teach the trainers, and then we certify them so that they can train the students. So once we train the students, the students will also get a certificate from US as well that they have been trained on that. So we don't do any training in-house in our office. Prakash, I think we work only on SLS material, that is the selective laser solidification. We don't have anything else, no binder, no filament, nothing. Amit, how to design or give supports to hanging structures for 3D printing, which is the simple way. See, actually the design rule, if you're talking about the metal, the design rule is if the overhanging is more than 1.5 mm, definitely you need to give a support, or else there is something called as the concept which is called downskin upskin concept. So the downskin will burn the first layers which is on hanging, and it will damage the part. So definitely you need to give supports if the overhang is more than 1.5 mm. So if you avoid the supports, maybe you can work in the part in such a way that you can avoid supports, or you can give the minimal support. I hope I've answered all the questions.
Yes, sir. Thank you both, Daniel sir and Sudhakar sir, for such an informative lecture and patiently answering all the questions. Thanks for spending your time and helping us out in making this FTP more informative with respect to 3D printing. And
thank you for giving the opportunity to address to such a big forum and such a nice questions. Our pleasure.
Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.